Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hunger by Stefan Máni, translated by Philip Routon, narrated by Ulf Bjorklund. Red-haired giant. Summer vacation. The silence is nearly absolute. All that can be heard is the gurgling of the stream, a low whisper as the breeze stirs the grass, and the faint footsteps of the red-haired giant walking slowly over the tussocky ground, with a stream on one hand and a rocky mountainside on the other. Across the stream are hills and slopes, and then another mountain that meets the first at the head of the fjord. Autumn comes much earlier this far north. The summer colors have faded, are almost gone, as if some bloodthirsty vermin had sucked all the life out of the delicate vegetation. The grass is yellow, the moss pale gray. The dainty flowers are bent and pale, and the grass blades as brittle as matches. The days are no longer long and bright. They're shortening rapidly. The temperature is dropping, and the light is turning little by little into lifeless darkness. From afar comes dark undertones, the ocean's low roar, and small rocks fall now and then from the mountain's craggy belts. The red-haired giant's name is Herder Grimsson, and he's a police detective. He's only 36, but is an old soul, as it's said. He's wearing a green army jacket, jeans, and rubber boots, and is holding a fishing box in his left hand and a fishing rod in his right. He ambles along, sometimes glancing at the gurgling stream, but most of the time he stares downward as he walks, either deep in thought or distracted. He's finally alone, on a short vacation from work, and at the same time, skipping out on a 3-day family reunion with his live-in partner and their son. He is doing what he's been dreaming of all spring and all summer, to get away for a little fishing all by himself. Far from human habitations, crimes, death, stress, and distractions. And here he is, way up north in the Strandir district, alone in the wilderness of the Vestfjords, the remote fjord-cut head of Iceland. Not a single person lives here, because it's hardly possible for anyone to do so. The only place more remote is the Hornastrandir area itself, in the Westfjord's northwesternmost reaches, accessible only by boat or helicopter. Finally, finally, Herder says to himself, in a weak attempt to live and enjoy, as fashion dictates. But the words are empty, and in his mind there is neither happiness nor peace. He felt good when he finally parked his SUV and shut off the engine the night before. He couldn't help but smile a little as he stepped out into the twilight. It had been exciting, finding a hollow and pitching his little dome tent. Nothing less than fantastic to warm baked beans on his Primus stove and drink coffee afterwards. But then he didn't sleep well. It had been ridiculously cold. An old back pain had returned. And, much to the policeman's chagrin, he'd felt a bit lonely in the darkness of his tent. Waking up at the cramped tent hadn't been particularly exciting either. Stiff and sluggish from lack of sleep. Everything wet outside, his clothing clammy. But it's a new day now, he tells himself in his mind, trudging along with his fishing gear. There's no need to get worked up over one lousy night in this tent. Accustoming oneself to changes takes time. And once upon a time, he was always on his own, never lonely. Just depressed and world-weary. So he must be able to stand being alone for a few days, right? Herder groans miserably. Sure, maybe. Still, he misses his family. He's got to admit that. The boy is definitely a bit of work, but he makes up for it with his innocent sincerity and joy. Herder's partner may talk a bit too much, but it's as if her absence is worse than her incessant chatter. And besides, Herder left in something of a huff. He probably hurt her a bit, which is why his conscience is nagging him. Women. He rolls his broad shoulders moodily and tries to shake off these thoughts and focus on what he's doing. He's camping, on a fishing trip, and he's going to enjoy it, damn it. Herder finds a decent-looking fishing spot, a large pool at a bend in the stream, under a heather-covered slope black with crowberries. If there's any life in this stream, it would be in a pool like this. He sits down on the slope and eats a few juicy berries, then opens his tackle box. He attaches a hook, a bobber, and a sinker to his line. One compartment of the tackle box holds a few fat earthworms and damp moss. He threads one of them onto the hook and walks softly over to the pool. The sky is partly clouded. The mouth of the fjord is bright, but it's darker near the mountains. Herder sits down on a mossy rock, lets out a little line, and casts gently into the pool, whose surface ripples when the bobber hits it. The bobber bobs on the surface, but the hook sinks into the shadow of the bank, down into the depths. The line is almost invisible, but if all goes well, it will soon connect a sprightly trout with two giant hands carefully holding a slender pole. Herder waits patiently. Finally, he forgets everything but the here and now. Water, a pole, and mysteries shrouded in darkness. He's both excited and relaxed, lost in the present. Time passes like a gurgling stream. A little bite. Something nips at the bait. His heart beats faster. The rod twitches. The line quivers. The bobber sinks. His eyes open wide. The fire crackles amicably in the circular fire pit, casting a red glow on the chiseled face of Herder, who is sitting in a folding chair, his shadow on the tent behind him. The sun is setting, blood red and dark. The mountains merge with the twilight, and the air cools rapidly. On the fire is a cast-iron pan, upon which a filleted trout is frying in butter, seasoned with sea salt and Arctic thyme from the nearest tussock. The aroma is delightful, to put it mildly. Herder turns the fillets over carefully, sprinkles a little salt on the fried side, and licks his lips. The skin is now crispy and slightly burnt, the way he likes it. The fish's pink flesh is just about cooked through. Herder takes a drink of his cold beer, the last one from the six-pack he brought with him, and sighs with pleasure. He's tired, but happy. He had cooled his beers in the stream. At this moment, he's perfectly happy, done fishing for his dinner and lighting a fire, and now just waiting patiently for the food to be ready. He has everything he needs and is completely content, for the moment at least. The smell of the fish, the crackling of the fire, the sunset and cold beer. What more could a mortal soul ask for in this poor earthly life? Companionship, his conscience whispers in his ear. The presence of the woman he loves. And who loves, tolerates, and understands him. The policeman grunts and rolls his shoulders. Yeah, yeah. But sometimes, like now, he just finds it better being alone. He appreciates the silence, the peace, this pure and clear connection with nature. When the fish is ready, Herder takes the pan off the fire. In its place, he purchases mocha pot on top of two of the rocks forming the fire pit. The fire licks the bottom of the pot and heats the water in it, eventually making it boil and press its way up through the ground coffee in the pot's middle section and collect a boiling hot espresso in the top section. He eats the fish directly from the pan, crunching the crispy skin, smacking his lips as he eats the soft flesh and finally sucking the bones and his buttery fingers. He finishes his beer, ending with a loud burp. At the same moment, the mocha pot hisses and gurgles, and steam streams from its narrow spout. Great timing! Herder takes the pot from the rocks, pours pitch-black coffee into a brown cup, leans back in his folding chair, and inhales the aroma of freshly brewed coffee. The sun is just about set. The sky is a deep red, and the mountains, shore, and hills have run together into one big silhouette that will soon engulf everything. Then the campfire will be the only light in the whole world, apart from a million stars that will reflect it straight across the vast reaches of outer space. Perfect, the red-haired giant whispers, almost teary-eyed with rapture, with simple and unadulterated happiness. This evening is glorious, immaculate, purely holy, and it's wordless. He flinches. Startled out of these lofty thoughts by the ringing of his cell phone. Who the hell? Herder springs to his feet, splashing coffee from his cup. Coffee he hadn't even gotten to taste. He curses and swears, crawls into the tent and tries to find the damn phone, which rings and rings as if the world were perishing. Who the hell is calling now? He should have switched off that infernal device. He'd actually thought that this deserted fjord was outside the service area, but that doesn't seem to be the case. Finally, he finds the phone and sees that it's his boss who's calling. The man called Steppenwolf. It must be something important. Yes? How are you doing? Fine. Are you at your family reunion? No, actually not. I've taken a little fishing trip. Herder is sitting hunched in the confined tent, with his phone to his ear and locks of his tousled hair hanging down over his forehead. Where have you gone fishing? Up north, Strandir. He'd left the town of Holmavik and driven as far north as he could, fjord after fjord, headland after headland, along a bumpy gravel road that grew narrower and bumpier until it became a trail that then evaporated into nothing. He thinks he's in Ofeigsfjörður, but isn't sure. He's basically nowhere. But it isn't enough. Caught anything? The red-haired giant sighs. What do you need? Am I on summer vacation, or... Yes, in a way. But of course, we're never really fully on vacation. At least, we're short-staffed right now. And? Do you know a small-boat fisherman from the west named Sigurjón? Apparently he knew your dad. Herder's mood darkens. His past is both painful and murky. Out west, everyone knows everyone else. What about this Sigurjón? His boy disappeared. A child? No, a boy of around 20. Disappeared how? It's a mystery, but maybe he's just abroad. Still, there's something peculiar about it all. What are you talking about? Herder asked irritably. Is someone missing or not? Abroad or not? I'll tell you more about it if you come south. I can assign this case to someone else in a day or two. There's no rush. Just let me know. I'm sure it can wait. I'm on vacation. I'm going to go on with my vacation, mutters the red-haired giant. I understand. Just pretend I didn't call. The red-haired giant hangs up and shakes his head, pissed off and somewhat disconcerted, having been as calm as an elderly Buddhist monk when his phone rang, having finally found a little peace of mind. What fucking bullshit was this? Bothering him because of some missing person who maybe wasn't missing? Can he never get any peace? He looks testily at the illuminated screen. The phone's battery's almost dead. Should he let it die? Charge the fucker. He's more inclined to doing the first. But if his partner can't reach him, she'll be worried. And that he really doesn't want. Herder goes to his SUV, which is parked on a bare patch of ground, a short distance above the trail that ended there at the edge of the world. The SUV is black, but so dusty and muddy that it blends in with its environment in the twilight. Herder unlocks the vehicle remotely, and its signal lights flash and interior light comes on. He gets into the driver's seat, switches on the electricity, and plugs his phone in next to the cigarette lighter. The phone beeps, and the batteries start charging. Lying in the back seat, hanging partly down to the floor, is the giant's leather coat, pitch black and made of thick, shiny cowhide. In the twilight, the coat looks most like a giant bat or the skin of a dragon. The policeman sits behind the wheel and stares into the darkness outside. Apart from the dying campfire and the stars in the sky, not a light is visible as far as the eye can see. 10 minutes ago, he'd been looking forward to crawling, tired and happy, into his sleeping bag in the cold tent. Now he shudders at the thought. The damn phone call robbed him of any calm. His blood pressure has risen and his mind is agitated. He'd managed to forget about work. But work didn't forget about him. If only he could relax a bit, the red-haired giant thinks, sighing heavily. But then he remembers something and opens the SUV's glove compartment. In it is an unopened half-pint of cognac that he'd bought for the family reunion he disappeared from, just to warm himself up on a chilly late summer evening. He holds the bottle up to the SUV's dim interior light. Its contents glug amicably. They're copper-colored, with a deep undertone and a shadow in the middle, as if there's a miniature abyss lurking behind the glass. A black hole that can suck him in. The giant's heart beats faster, and his mouth goes dry. Lightning cleaves the darkness, followed by a rumble of thunder. It's pouring rain and the night is dark and gloomy. An old car is driven fast along a country road through a wooded area and up a gentle slope. It's a 1955 Chevrolet Bel Air, red with a white roof and white tail end, chrome bumpers and a pointed hood ornament. Behind the wheel sits a young woman in a beige coat with a kerchief tied over her head. She holds the steering wheel with her gloved hands and stares intently into the black. The windshield wipers fight against the rain. The wind blows the treetops to and fro. The woman drives like there's no time to waste, as if her life depended on it. In the distance, a great castle looms in the night, illuminated by lightning and a full moon that appears between drifting clouds. The woman parks the car in front of the darkened castle, goes out into the rainstorm, and hurries to the huge door. She knocks on it and waits for someone to let her in. The door opens slowly with a creak. In the doorway stands a slender figure wearing a gray hooded sweatshirt and carrying some sort of shoulder bag, green in color. Under the hood, neither face nor eyes, just darkness. Inside the castle, it's dim and cold. The woman follows the hooded figure down a long hallway. Their footsteps echo in the silence. They enter a spacious hall, the walls of which are hung with flickering torches that conjure both light and shadow, dancing shadows. On a throne sits a young boy of around 13 or 14 years old, it appears. He's wearing a wide black leather jacket, pressed trousers, and a white shirt. His dirty blonde hair is slicked back with gel, and he's wearing brand new basketball shoes and a red bow tie. His face is childish, but his eyes are like those of a doll, lifeless and cold. The hooded figure had taken an inconspicuous position at the back corner of the throne. "Welcome," the boy says as he steps down from the throne. "Thank you for responding so quickly to my call." "Your Highness, you said it was a matter of life and death," says the woman. She removes her kerchief and peels off her gloves. Then she bows to the boy. "That's right," says the boy. About his childish lips plays a faint smile, but his eyes are like black stones. "I'm unwell, you see. I've been unwell for a long time, as you may know. They've tried everything, everything, I say, and now the drugs don't do any good anymore. On the contrary, they've made me sicker. They've poisoned my blood. It's turning to powder." "Oh, no," says the woman. The boy nods. "The only thing that can save me is blood. The blood of others, not animals, unfortunately. It's been tried. Blood from other people, from volunteers like you." The woman bows again. "Mama," says the boy dramatically, "my mama has done her best, but it's not enough. She..." He falls silent as footsteps draw near. Into the hall walks an elderly woman, dressed in a bathrobe and felt shoes. Holding a silver platter, she walks slowly toward the boy and the woman. The old woman has no head. On her shoulders is a television set. On the screen flickers a black-and-white image of an old woman, wrinkled and gray-haired. "I had to take off her head, as you see," says the boy. "It's the pièce de résistance of my collection. Would you like me to take off your head, too? In my collection, the souls stare forever out of the eyes of the dead." "Do what you have to do," says the woman. She sees that the old woman is carrying a hammer and a large knife on the platter. The boy nods. "Come on, lie down here. Make yourself comfortable." The woman does as he says. In the hall is a plain altar, a dark gray stone block covered with dark spatters and streaks of a dried substance. The woman takes off her shoes and coat. She's wearing a short yellow dress that bulges in front. The woman lies down on the cold block, obedient and submissive. The boy takes the hammer from the platter. On it are dried blood, slivers of bone and hair. "Maybe I should close my eyes?" the woman whispers. The boy nods. The woman closes her eyes again. She hears her own heartbeat and feels the blood rushing through the veins. The blood that isn't just the mainstay of her life, but also that of her baby, who... "The baby," the woman whispers. "She's pregnant. How could she have forgotten that? She's 5 months pregnant." "No!" screams the woman, opening her eyes at the same time. Icy moonlight shines through spiry windows high above her. Countless bats flutter through the window, huge with red eyes and long claws and teeth. The sound they make pierced the marrow of her bones. The bloodsuckers flap their wings wildly as they descend and attack the woman, who fights back furiously. What? No! The red-haired giant twitches. His head is full of heavy wing beats. Big red-eyed bats dart all around him, squeaking noisily. He wakes with a start, groans, and reaches out into the empty air as his eyes become accustomed to the dim light, and he realizes where he is. His tent, of course. The wind outside pulls and stretches it, making it flap. The wings that woke him belong neither to bats nor flying dragons, but are made of lifeless nylon fastened to the ground with stakes. He is relieved, but is then overwhelmed with malaise, headache, stomach ache, and nausea. The cognac, what a mistake. He'd drunk the whole half pint like an idiot. The giant closes his eyes and dreams of falling asleep again, but he feels too awful, both sweaty and cold in the airless tent, which is on the verge of blowing down. Dream? Hadn't he dreamed something? He thinks so, but he isn't sure. Then a few images flash like sparks through his fragile mind. A vintage car, a thunderstorm, a castle, a hooded shadow figure, an adolescent boy, a pregnant woman, fluttering bats, a hammer and a knife, and an anguished scream. Had someone said something about a collection? He opens his bloodshot eyes wide, and for a moment his piercing headache disappears. A young woman is in danger, of that he's sure. A pregnant woman. The dream signifies it. The bats attacked her. Or was it the boy with the doll eyes? The policeman shuts his eyes again, tries to travel back into his dreams and get more information, clues. But the other world is dark and empty at this moment, closed and locked outside the service area. But the woman isn't dead, he believes. Not yet, at least. Wouldn't he sense it if she were? Wouldn't he feel a piercing chill, feel emptiness in his soul, even see her death shadow? The giant groans softly. Or was it just a dream? An alcohol-fueled nightmare? Maybe. Very likely. But the wind is picking up, if anything. The tent flaps like the sails of a schooner on stormy seas. The red-haired giant staggers to his feet. He unzips the tent flap and peeks out. The sky is covered with black billowing clouds. It's cold and dim outside, and the mountains are gray and bleak. The vegetation colorless and dead. Summer is clearly at an end. Autumn has officially taken over. He crawls half-naked down to the stream, lies down on the bank and gulps the ice-cold water. It energizes him a bit. He hurries back into the flapping tent and zips the flap shut again. He needs to get dressed, pack his things, pack up the tent, and get out of here. The fishing trip is over. But first, he has to make one phone call. When he finally finds his cursed cell phone, he sees that someone has called him 3 times. Turns out to be his partner. His guilt transforms into a hard knot in his stomach. He'll call back soon. First, he needs to compose himself a bit and get hold of Steppenwolf. He looks up his reason call and selects his boss's number.
Yes?
Herder clears his throat vigorously. Has a woman been attacked? He then asks, hoarse as a crow.
A woman? Attacked? No, not that I know. Why do you ask?
Just because, he murmurs.
But is there any news about the boy who disappeared, or didn't disappear?
Why are you asking these questions? Are you on your way south?
I can't get much further north, that's for sure, mutters the pale giant.
He sits flat-legged in his tent, bent back with his hand on his cheek, like a human dragon in the shelter of his own wings. A black Ford Explorer drives quickly southward down Norðurárdalur Valley, with a tree-grown slope on one side and a nearly waterless runoff stream on the other. Herder Grimsson is sitting behind the wheel, staring at the road ahead. Bibi is in the passenger seat, and Peter, their just over 3-year-old son, is sitting in a child seat in back. It's growing dark. The sun has gone down behind the mountains to the west. The landscape is spectacular in the changing light, fairy-tale-esque and captivating. The silence in the car is both welcome and oppressive. Bibi looks in the back seat and sees that the boy is asleep. Herder tenses up. He knows that Bibi will break the silence.
Why did you run off? She asks.
We go to a family reunion, as a family. Then you just disappear, leave us behind? Herder doesn't know what to say. I just felt like I was suffocating. All those people. I don't feel comfortable in crowds. All those people, exclaims Bibi. It was barely 100, and they're my relatives, my family. Herder grunts.
Yeah, exactly. Your family.
What are you saying, she asks. That my family has nothing to do with you? He sighs.
No, I... You know that I don't feel well surrounded by lots of people. I don't know what to say or do. I'm not interested in those people. I'm not interested in any people.
But they're interested in you, says Bibi, hurt. They want to get to know you and learn more about you. Because you are in the family, whether you like it or not.
Get to know me, yeah, mutters Herder. In other words, to ask me about work, because I'm a cop. They want to know all about investigations, murders, and all the things I don't want to talk about at all.
I know, says Bibi. But you could have discussed it with me instead of bringing an extra tent and fishing gear.
I brought that stuff just in case, he says sheepishly.
Bibi shakes her head. Obviously, you never meant to be with us at the family reunion. That's just how it is.
He decides not to say anything, since there's not much he can say without agreeing to what she has said. She's right, of course. They drive on in oppressive silence, having reached the broad forested Borgarfjörður area. Herder spots a small sign to his right. Land for sale. On the sign is a phone number that he memorizes.
The Long Sleep. Tuesday.
Herder parked his SUV in the parking lot in front of Hotel Nordica on Söderlandsbrott Road. For decades, the hotel had the beautiful name Esja, after the mountain across the bay, but it's now stuck with that vapid appellation. Herder opens his notepad and goes over the notes he's jotted in it. The man he's going to meet is named Sigurjón Ágústsson, a 48-year-old small boat fisherman from Ísafjörður who is staying at the hotel. He came to the capital before the weekend, looking for his son, Jón Gunnar, 20 years old. Nothing has been heard from the young man since the 14th of July, almost a month, which doesn't bode well at all. Herder shuts off the engine and steps out, wearing his black leather coat over a black shirt and black trousers. It's a few minutes to 11 in the morning. The temperature is 15 degrees, and there's a pleasant breeze from the east. When Herder enters the lobby, he sees a tan man sitting at a table to the right, not far from a stylish fireplace in which gas or ethanol fire is burning. The man has grizzled hair and long sideburns, and is wearing jeans and an unbuttoned denim shirt over a T-shirt sporting a Rock Band logo. He appears healthy, but is clearly broken. Under his bloodshot eyes are dark rings, and he can't sit still, as if he's on edge. He probably hasn't slept much due to stress and worry. But maybe he just wants a cigarette. On the table in front of him is an empty coffee cup, and his left shirt pocket bulges with a pack of cigarettes. Sigurjón? Herder asks, without doubting for a second that this is the man he agreed to meet. Small boat fishermen such as him are almost always muscular, sinewy, and as tan as fitness buffs, nearly dark brown. But unlike the latter group, their muscles come from honest work, and their tans are real, not some gravy color sprayed on their bodies.
Herder? Sigurjón gets to his feet and greets the policeman.
I remember your dad, Grimur. He was one hell of a fisherman, and a great...
He stops, seemingly embarrassed.
Partier? Herder asks coldly, before taking a seat.
Let's talk about your son instead. Jón Gunnar. Whether you remember my dad or not is irrelevant to the investigation.
Yes, of course, Sigurjón mutters as he sits back down.
Would you like something to drink? Coffee? Soda?
Herder shakes his head. He wants a beer and a cigarette. Mainly a cigarette.
But he promised Bibi he would stop. Once again.
He sees that the shirt Sigurjón is wearing under his denim one is an old faded Rolling Stones concert T-shirt from the Steel Wheels tour. The last one with Bill Wyman aboard. The policeman's opinion of the fisherman goes up a bit. Herder himself has never seen the Stones live.
What do you want to know?
Sigurjón rubs his calloused hands together. Herder opens his notepad and clicks open his pen.
Tell me everything. I leave nothing out. It's up to me to judge what matters and what doesn't.
Sigurjón nods.
Fine.
My nonny, Jung Gunnar, had saved up a very long time for this trip of his. He'd been fishing with me since he was 16, but I don't know if he could see doing it for the rest of his life. Probably not. He was restless and wanderlust. A big world pulled at him. He was going to start this world tour of his in South America. He'd booked a flight with Iceland Air to Orlando, Florida, this past July 14th. He took the bus to town 2 days earlier with his backpack and tent. His mom heard from him last when he was in Reykjavik. He said he would call before he boarded the plane. But he never called. I wasn't worried about it, but then time passed and we haven't heard anything from him, his mother and I. It's been a month. Sigurjon's voice breaks, and he clears his throat and blinks his eyes. Hurda flips a few pages back in his notepad. Axel looked into it a bit, as you know. Jon Gunnar never boarded the plane, and he seems to have switched off his phone after he called his mother. He was probably at the central bus station in Vassbyri at the time. Nor did he use his debit or credit card since later that day, when, on the one hand, he bought something to eat at Café Paris in the city center, and on the other, withdrew 10,000 kroner from an ATM on Österstræti Street, a stone's throw from Café Paris. Sigurjon nods. That all sounds right. What do you think has happened? Herder decides to avoid the question, at least for now. There could be several answers to it, none of them reassuring. Why do you think he switched off his phone? He asks in return. To save the battery. Sigurjon answers without hesitation. He was heading out on a backpacking trip and had to save his phone's battery. You never know when you'll be able to charge your phone next. He'd already explained that to us, so that we wouldn't worry unnecessarily if we couldn't reach him. Very well, says Herder. But do you have any idea where he was planning on camping here in the capital area? Sigurjon says no. Maybe in Lugardalr, suggests Herder, at the campsite there. Sigurjon shrugs. Maybe. But I think it's more likely that he was just going to pitch his tent anywhere that would work, you know. He wasn't much for spending money if he could avoid it. I see, says Herder. He notices that Sigurjon is talking about his son in the past tense. In other words, he apparently isn't optimistic about the boy still being alive. Neither is the policeman. Which complicates things, of course. But I'll stop by the Laugadalr campsite and see if any of the staff there remembers him. Good idea, says Sigurjon. I'll let Axel have a photo of Jon Gunnar. He was wearing jeans, a t-shirt, and a denim jacket when he left for his trip, if that helps at all. And he usually wore round sunglasses, dark blue. All such information helps, says Herder. I have a few photocopies of the photo in the car. He's called Nonni, isn't he, Jon Gunnar? By those who knew him, yes, replies Sigurjon. Then he pats his shirt pocket holding the cigarette pack. A habitual movement, Herder assumes. He is familiar with it, checking to see if he still has some smokes. Herder clears his throat. There's one thing I've got to ask you. Two things, actually. Sigurjon sighs. Shoot. First of all, says the officer, could Jon Gunnar have owed anyone anything? Or had he beef or something left unsettled with someone? In other words, is it possible that anyone had a reason to harm him? Sigurjon takes a deep breath. The question obviously hits him quite hard, since Herder is implying that someone may have killed his son. I don't think so. Not at all. Drugs? Gambling debts? Love affairs? Herder asks gently. Sigurjon shakes his head. Very well, says Herder, who certainly knows how parents never know everything about their children. Which brings me to my second question. Could Jon Gunnar have taken his own life? Has he struggled with depression or anything like that? Did he recently break up with a girl? Not at all, Sigurjon says, with a hint of anger in his voice. He was a very upbeat young man, and there was no woman in his life. He was a loner, but far from being depressed or anything like that. If you had known him, then... The fisherman's voice breaks again, and tears well in his eyes. I had to ask. I hope you understand, says Herder sympathetically. Sigurjon nods, then raises his cup to take a sip of coffee, but the cup has been empty the entire time. How about we get a refill on our coffee and then step outside for a smoke? Herder suggests. Sounds good. Sigurjon squeezes out a smile. They stand under the awning in front of the hotel,
smoking silently. Sigurjón got a refill on his coffee, and Herder bought a cup. The policeman appreciates this sort of company, this everyday activity that reminds him of his old hometown of Súðavík and life in the countryside. Two men, one a fisherman, and the other an ex-fisherman, drinking black coffee and smoking together in silence. Contrary to the arts and culture go-getter types in the capital, especially the city center, old salts like he and Sigurjón have no need to blather incessantly. They have a lot in common, but it's nothing needing discussing. Herder looks at the t-shirt Sigurjón is wearing. Did you see them, the stones, on that tour? Sigurjón nods and blows smoke out his nostril. Yes, sir, at the Olympic Stadium in Los Angeles in 1989. Living color and Guns N' Roses with the warm-up bands. Awesome. Herder takes a drag of his cigarette. Guns N' Roses is one of the bands that he absolutely can't stand. But he wouldn't have minded seeing them in 89 before they went completely to the dogs. Eric Clapton came out on stage with the Stones, says Sigurjón proudly. Played Little Red Rooster with them. Nice, says Herder. Doesn't really like Clapton either, apart from the Cream years, maybe. So, you traveled a bit in your younger years. Yeah, a bit, says Sigurjón. The boy probably got the bug from me, my nonny. I was just thinking that, says Herder. They finished their coffees and cigarettes in silence and looked toward Essia across the bay, without though looking at anything in particular. What now? Sigurjón asks, after they stubbed out their smokes. I'll try to find out what happened to the boy, says Herder. How long will you be in town? I have to check out at noon, Sigurjón answers. I can't afford to stay here much longer. And anyway, I need to get back out to sea. Summer's almost finished. The autumn storms are around the corner. Herder nods. I'll be in touch soon. Sigurjón smiles a crooked smile. There's little else in his eyes but hopelessness and sorrow. Both men know that there's little hope of good news. Thanks. No problem, says Herder. They part with a handshake. And then the policeman walks to his SUV without looking over his shoulder. He knows how it is to lose parents and siblings, but can hardly imagine what it's like to fear for the life of your child. Herder is sitting in his SUV in the parking lot of the campsite in Laugadalur. He has already spoken to the staff on duty at the moment and showed them the photo of Jón Gunnar. No one recognized him from the photo. In it, he's sitting on a couch with an acoustic guitar in his arms, smiling widely. Herder has the feeling that people would remember Jón Gunnar once they'd met him. He seems like the type who's always enthusiastic, gets to know people easily, and loves to play guitar and sing Steel and Knife by Bobby Mortens and House of the Rising Sun by The Animals. Still, Sigurjón said that his son was a loner and that he'd probably camped somewhere without a permit, so as not to have to spend any of his travel money. But if he didn't camp at Laugadalur, where did he? Presumably in a green space where there was shelter and privacy. It's illegal to camp outside of official campsites, so he probably chose a place where he couldn't be seen from a road or nearby houses. Herder unlocks his cell phone and opens Google Maps. He enlarges the map and scrolls slowly over the capital region. The biggest green spaces are at Öskjulíð, Fossvogur, Grafavogur, and Etlidaldalur. Smaller areas, such as Bandstand Park, Klumbrothen Park, and Laugadalur, are organized, well-groomed public parks, making it doubtful that anyone would think of camping there. The entire Forsvogur area is more or less a public park, actually. It does, however, have a few wooded spaces, especially at its western end. The Grafavogur district was also possible, especially the area in the vicinity of Keldur. There is more to the Öskjulíð hill area that meets the eye. It's large and its trees are tall, and is used by a lot of people for walking, jogging, or biking. Most of the area, though, is sloping, with little grassy ground. It's more just hard forest floor. Of all these green spaces, the Etlidaldalur River Valley is the only real wild woodland, although, of course, it's not a real forest, and the area is defined as an outdoor recreation area, not a protected park. The valley is wide enough, and the forest big and dense enough that someone could probably find quite a few desirable and even remote spots to camp at, and in doing so experience peace and tranquility within the bounds of the capital. Though there's hardly any dead silence in the valley,
What with a dual carriageway of Reykjanesbrout Highway running alongside it, with its associated car traffic day and night, Herder suddenly thinks of the sign he saw up in Borgarfjörður, land for sale. He was going to write down the phone number of the sign at the first opportunity, but never did. Maybe he can still remember it. He enters the number on the keypad on his phone, hesitates, but then presses the green phone icon. It rings on the other end. Then a male voice answers. Ness Real Estate Agency? That afternoon, Herder knocks on the door of his boss's office. Come in, calls out old Steppenwolf. Herder walks in and takes a seat in one of the chairs in front of the hefty desk. Axel M. Axelson takes off his reading glasses and looks inquiringly at the red-haired giant. Ceiling light gleams on his bald head. Herder clears his throat and tells his boss about his meeting with Sigurjun and visit to the campsite in Laugardalur. The staff I met weren't necessarily working when you and Gunnar might have camped in Laugardalur. They simply couldn't remember, says Herder. So I left a photo of you and Gunnar, which they were going to hang up in their office, in case any of the ones who weren't working today might recognize the boy. But you doubt that he camped there? Axel asks. Herder nods. If anything happened to the boy, whether it was an accident or something else, shouldn't the tent still be there where he pitched it? And even his things, too? His backpack? You'd think that if he camped in Laugardalur, an unoccupied tent and abandoned backpack wouldn't have escaped the staff's notice. You're probably right, says Axel. But where did he camp? If he camped somewhere, that is. If he camped somewhere, exactly, says Herder. We don't know if he pitched his tent or not. The boy seems to have simply evaporated into thin air. But he is somewhere, alive or dead. And if he camps somewhere, I want to find his tent. That makes the two of us, says Axel heavily. I really don't care for yet another unsolved disappearance. I've already seen far too many of them. Could the boy have owed money or been involved in some dubious activity? Of course, it's not out of the question, says Herder. But still, there's nothing indicating it. He withdrew 10,000 kroner from an ATM. That amount doesn't raise any suspicions. I understand, says Axel. I want to meet with a search and rescue team tomorrow, preferably in the morning, says Herder. I want an organized search to be carried out at all the bigger green spaces in the capital. Axel nods thoughtfully. I'll contact the regional administration of search and rescue. Anything else? Herder clears his throat. I was wondering if I could take care of a bit of private business tomorrow afternoon. I need to head up to Borgarfjörður for a bit. I will leave at noon. It shouldn't take more than about 3.5 hours. I'd be back by 3:30, 4 o'clock at the latest. If it doesn't interfere with work, Axel mutters. It shouldn't, says Herder. Not with things as they are now, anyway. But as you know, I'll just work longer when necessary. Fine, says Axel. But what the hell are you going to do up in Borgarfjörður? Herder grins. I'm going to meet another man in an isolated clearing. How does that sound? Axel sighs. Note to self, stop asking Herder Grimsson personal questions. It's just over 8 o'clock, and Herder is sitting on his living room sofa, distractedly watching TV, which is playing some educational program about people's diets. Hanging in the air is the aroma of the North African lamb dish that Bibi made. And on the coffee table in front of the policeman is an empty coffee cup. Bibi is upstairs, bathing little Peter, who will go straight to bed afterward. In fact, Herder hears that the little one's bath is finished. Herder and Bibi always takes turns putting the boy to bed. Herder generally reads a little to Peter, then he kisses the boy on the forehead, says goodnight, and leaves the room. Bibi has more trouble with the process. Peter is good at getting his mommy to read to him for a long time and then sing countless lullabies to stretch out the time even more. Then he pesters his mom until she lies down with him. And that's where she has to stay until he falls asleep. More than once she has fallen asleep with the boy, even ahead of him. Then has a harder time doing so later that evening, when she really must get some sleep. Herder lets this acquiescence and indulgence of hers get on his nerves. He's stubborn, firm, and determined, and has a hard time understanding people aren't exactly like that. But just now, as so often before, in fact, he's really hoping that Bibi falls asleep with the boy, because he wants a bit of peace and quiet and to do what he wants, alone and undisturbed. He listens and hears nothing. Neither soft voices nor a sweet lullaby. Are they asleep?
He holds his breath, then nods slowly. Yes, in all likelihood. Herder gets down on his knees and flips through his DVD collection, which is on the bottom two shelves of a bookcase in the living room. The collection consists mainly of old cowboy and crime movies from the mid-20th century, but he also has a few movies from the 1960s and 70s, mostly crime and mafia movies. In his opinion, that period, from 1940 to 1980, is the only true golden age of Hollywood. After 1980, nothing but rubbish came out of the old Dream Factory, with very few exceptions. He has seen these films more than once, more than twice, some even 10 times. He wants to watch a detective movie, and has already chosen Polanski's Chinatown, when he sets eyes on The Big Sleep, with Humphrey Bogart and Lauren Bacall. He knows The Big Sleep almost by heart, both the movie and the book by Raymond Chandler. Chinatown is a better movie with a better story and even better actors, but there's something about The Big Sleep that pulls at him. Maybe it's Bogart, with his ungainly grin and his black-and-white charm. Maybe it's the pointed and witty patter of the hard-boiled thriller. Maybe it's just a nostalgic longing for simpler times that will never return. After putting the disc in the player, Herder slips into the kitchen and opens the fridge. In the vegetable drawer, under a bag of potatoes, he has hidden 3 cans of Tuborg Classic. He grabs one and hurries back into the dusky living room. He plunks down on the sofa, presses play, and opens the can. He makes sure that the TV's volume isn't too high. Herder takes a drink of the cold, frothy beer and sighs. What bliss. Just him, the couch, beer, and Bogart. The only thing missing is a cigarette or a cigar. The film's first scene is his favorite. Philip Marlowe has come to the mansion of General Sternwood, a wealthy widower, a millionaire who's confined to a wheelchair and can't drink or smoke for health reasons. The meeting between the private detective and the general takes place in a hot and humid greenhouse full of orchids, which the general dislikes, as they remind him of the flesh of men and smell of the rotten sweetness of corruption. Herder smiles. So eloquent. Marlowe accepts a brandy and takes off his jacket, having started sweating. The general has 2 daughters, who are apparently quite wild. Marlowe has come across the younger one in the hall, a blonde beauty queen in a very short skirt. She's fallen into his lap, despite the fact that he was standing, as Marlowe tells the general.
What are you watching?
Bibby asks with a yawn. Herder is startled. He hadn't heard her come. He was sipping his beer, which splutters out his nose.
Nothing special,
Herder replies as he wipes his face with a shirt sleeve. He puts down the beer can and stops the movie. Did we have beer?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.